Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Sunshine Menezes. I am the Executive Director of Metcalf Institute at the University of Rhode Island, and I am absolutely delighted that you could join us today for this lunchtime talk, brown bag in, you know, like the sense of the old pre-pandemic days when we were brown bagging more often, to welcome, and I'm pleased to welcome Sonia Narang for this talk. I would like to give you a little bit of a description about Sonia and tell you who's sponsoring this talk today, and then we'll get right into it. So Sonia Narang is a multimedia journalist who covers climate change and the environment, global health, music and culture, as well as immigration issues. And she primarily focuses her reporting on the lives of women and girls, especially the challenges they face around the world. Sonia's journalism has taken her across Asia and the Pacific, Europe, Africa, and North America, from covering indigenous fashion in Canada to how women farmers are affected by cyclones in Fiji, and many, many other stories in between. She has produced and reported stories for PRI's The World, the BBC, the New York Times, the Global Post, PBS NewsHour, Frontline, Time.com, and NBC News, among others. She has a master's degree in documentary filmmaking from the University of California, Berkeley Graduate School of Journalism. And I'm very happy to note that she is also an alumna of Metcalf Institute's annual Science Immersion Workshop for Journalists. She posts her photography from around the world on Instagram and Twitter with the handle @SoniaNarang. I highly recommend you follow her because her photographs are beautiful. I love watching them, especially these days when we're not getting out so much. So it's a great way to see the world. I also am very pleased to note that this talk today is offered as part of the URI Graduate School of Oceanography's annual Vetlesen Distinguished Speaker Series, and it's presented in partnership with us at Metcalf Institute and the Rhode Island Consortium for Coastal Ecology Assessment, Innovation, and Modeling, also known as Rhode Island CAIM, as part of the Career Development Program. The Vetlesen Lecture is sponsored by the G. Unger Vetlesen Foundation, which since its founding in 1955 has advanced prominent oceanographic and earth science institutions in the United States. Rhode Island CAIM is a collaboration of engineers, scientists, designers, and communicators from 8 higher education institutions in Rhode Island who are developing new approaches to assess, predict, and respond to the effects of climate change on coastal ecosystems. Metcalf Institute created the Career Development Program as part of Rhode Island CAIM to support the professional development of Rhode Island students and postdoctoral scholars. And we will hear more about this in a workshop component that is going to follow this public lecture today. As a reminder for everybody, the rules of engagement for this Zoom meeting are that we would ask everybody to mute yourself unless you're speaking. Please use the raise hand function to ask a question or just insert your question in the chat, and there'll be some time for Q&A at the end of Sonia's lecture. It'd be great to introduce yourself before speaking. Please, you know, turn your camera on if you're comfortable with that when you're asking a question, and be sure to give everybody a chance to contribute to the discussion. So with that, I am very happy to turn this over to Sonia.
Thank you very much, Sunshine. That was a very kind and thoughtful introduction. And I'm very excited to be here. Hopefully soon we can all continue to meet in person. But until then, good morning from Los Angeles, California, where I currently am, despite the beautiful Golden Gate Bridge behind me, since I have been working for a San Francisco radio station. But it's very exciting to present the session today. Can you see the opening slide here? Okay.
Not yet.
Okay. So it is up. I may have to share it again.
Probably.
Let me try again. So go back to share screen. Been using Zoom for more than a year, yet this is still always a new thing. And then I will go to play from start. Now, can you see it?
Yeah.
Beautiful. Okay. So As Sunshine mentioned, I have worked as a video journalist and filmmaker. And in this session, we're going to talk about how you can use video to effectively communicate your science to a general audience. And, you know, as someone who has been using Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, and also YouTube to present my video work, I'm very excited to talk about the various strategies and how those platforms can work for you as scientists. And please let me know your questions throughout. Sunshine will moderate a Q&A towards the end. So I'm very happy to answer any questions you have. But first I want to start with just explaining what exactly I mean when I say immersive short form video. I know that many of you have different experiences in watching videos or even making videos, but immersive videos usually take viewers into places that they have rarely seen. So into your world. Many viewers have no idea what a science lab looks like, what the field looks like where you work. So an immersive video in your case would take your viewers into your laboratory, into the marsh where you're working, into a computer modeling session, and really show people what you're seeing. They're usually under 5 minutes long. On social media, people tend to have a shorter attention span, but I'll go through the various video lengths in the various platforms. And these videos are, you know, short form videos are usually shared on social media platforms to reach a wider audience than you would normally reach because there are many more people in the world of YouTube and Facebook than there might be on an academic website or your own personal website. So some examples of short videos would include explainers, or videos that take people behind the scenes, or short interviews. And I'll go through and show you examples of some of those. But the first thing I want to open with is explaining why video is so crucial in helping all of you to get your work out into the world. So first of all, you know, it allows for you to directly share your science. A lot of times, you know, journalists like myself will take press releases or we'll interview you and we will relay information through our own lens to the world. But by making your own videos, you have this direct one-to-one conversation with an audience. And it also allows you to introduce yourself and your research to people outside your field. And one reason this is very important is because it allows you to reach a much more diverse group of people than you might normally be able to reach. You can reach people of all walks of life. There are so many users on these social media platforms, on YouTube, on Facebook, on Twitter and Instagram, and even TikTok, that you are able to reach people around the world, not necessarily in academia. And as I mentioned, you know, it allows you to get your voice directly to the public instead of letting journalists or, you know, other people who may not be experts in your field explain your science. And it also offers a way for you to put a human face on science. I often encourage people to be on camera. You know, I'm myself kind of the behind the camera personality, but I think for you, it's really, you know, engaging to have that opportunity to be on camera and put a human face to the work that you're doing. And then, you know, for your own career, it allows you to get more exposure, maybe get more research funding for the work you're doing and publishing in journals. So there's a lot of benefits. And how exactly these videos can reach large audiences, there's so many ways in which you can reach out to people, but on platforms like Twitter and Facebook, people are resharing what they find interesting. And I'll talk about a few different strategies that you can use, but if you are able to make short videos, even video clips, showing people behind the scenes in your lab, you can even include a link to that video in a press release. And a journalist like myself or my colleagues will often just go ahead and embed your original video in our articles. And it's a great way to get more exposure in, you know, the BBC, the New York Times, Washington Post. And this way you can get your videos, your original videos directly into these big news organizations. And another big benefit is the ability to engage and interact with an audience. So, you know, you might not have that opportunity sitting in a in an academic setting, you know, to talk to people. And this way, you know, on Facebook or Instagram, you can engage and actually answer questions that people have about your work. So that's just to set the scene. And, you know, I'm going to talk about various social media platforms. And I have a poll, actually, before I get into it. Margaret can put that poll up. I wanted to get a straw poll of what social media platforms you use to watch videos. So please take a second to think about this and fill it out. Okay, we have a clear winner. Looks like YouTube has emerged. I'm gonna make a screenshot of this because it's quite interesting to see what different groups enjoy using. So YouTube and then Instagram, which is actually my personal favorite. I'm a big Instagrammer, as Sunshine mentioned. And my, you know, a lot of my knowledge of what's happening around the world comes from just viewing people's accounts on Instagram or people's feeds. It looks like very few of you are into Twitter. And there's about three on Facebook and three on TikTok. Okay, that's really great to know. In terms of the, you know, the various video platforms, YouTube is by far the largest social media platform. So I'm not surprised to see that 63% of you use YouTube the most. It's also a place where you can get, you know, longer form videos. People tend to watch even documentaries. They tend to watch with the audio on. They tend to focus more. Whereas on Twitter and Facebook and even Instagram, especially Twitter, videos kind of are not, you know, people don't have that big of an attention span. So I've put the famous French Dispatch meme up here. So you can see what the differences are. TikTok is more geared towards the young, you know, hip users, and, you know, it's more fun, catchy videos. Whereas Instagram is very much about polished, really nicely produced photos and video. So one reason that I got into Instagram is because I just love you know, filming with my iPhone, actually, and putting that content out there. And it's usually beautiful footage that I like to watch. And Twitter is kind of, you know, the relaxed Bill Murray in his Hawaiian shirt, because people don't spend too much time on Twitter videos, but things can go super viral on Twitter. That's where, you know, you can get people, millions of people viewing your video if you get lucky. And I've included a link here that includes descriptions of all the social media platforms in detail. But before we move on, I wanna go through some examples of what I mean by, you know, the difference between a Facebook video and an Instagram video. So let me see if I can pull up, instead of going that way, let's see if I can get into a new share. So I'm going to go into this and I'm going to show you a few examples of what I'm talking about. So this is an example of a video that you might see on YouTube. It's a professionally produced video.
Sixty-five-year-old Donald Dardar has been living off the land in Pointe-aux-Chaise, Louisiana, his whole life. His father taught him how to hunt when he was just a child.
My dad taught me everything that I needed to know about surviving, except neutral, coon, muskrat, otter.
But over the last several decades, rising water and sinking land have drowned most of his childhood hunting grounds.
But I've seen a lot of that disappearing. This is where we used to have land before, now we're shrimping on top of that. And the land's completely gone.
Marshes that were once thick and fertile are now a network of ever-growing saltwater canals.
Like now, the places that we used to do the trapping for the animal, you know, that it just washed all out away and it washed all the land out, and now we're fishing. We just kept adapting to the changes. That's our way of life down here, and that's what we're doing.
But that way of...
So, you know, as you can see, this is more of a professionally, I mean, this is a very professionally produced documentary, but it is a video that really takes you into this man's life. It takes you into this scene, and it's, you know, it gets deeper into the issue. This is a longer video. It's over 9 minutes long. Whereas in, you know, the case of Twitter and Instagram, you might see shorter clips. But I wanted you to get a sense of, you know, a YouTube video is generally deeper. It includes analysis, it includes narration, and it included, in this case, an interview subject. And then, you know, I'm going to move on to Instagram here.
Directly into a trend.
And this is a short video just showing how a pain-free glucose testing system developed in Australia could work instead of prick blood sugar tests.
What we've done is we've developed a way of embedding an enzyme that detects, in this case, glucose, directly into a transistor. Now, a transistor is a very sensitive amplifier. And so that enzyme that we put into the transistor, it turns glucose into a signal that the transistor can detect. But now it's a transistor that we can manufacture by printing it, because the electronic materials are all inks. We now have the prospect of diabetes sufferers being able to simply test using their saliva for their condition. So
in this video, you can see, you know, it's footage of some laboratory behind the scenes. And then, you know, the interview subject, the scientist, is on a video call. So it's a little less polished, it's simpler, and it's faster. It's a minute and a half video. You know, and in going through various Instagram pages, I found that science museums often do a very nice job at being able to communicate with a wider audience. So, you know, as you're looking to get into video, I would highly recommend going through some of the, like the Museum of Science in Boston, which used to be one of my favorite museums when I lived in Boston for the planetarium. You know, they've got an entire section of reels, and there's some pretty simple ones here. This one is about snails, and you can see these are fairly easy to make, something that you can even do with an iPhone. So I'll play this for a minute here.
I'm exploring the rocky shore in New England, seeing what I can find in the tide pools. This is a periwinkle snail. This marine snail is very common to New England. Snails are so cool because they make their own shells. They can't come fully out of their shell. The shell is part of their body, but they do come partially out to stick to rocks and to eat algae. A tip to get a snail to come out of its shell is to hum to it, which mimics the sound and feeling of crashing waves.
So I thought that was pretty cute. You know, it really just shows us the snail in the scientist's or the researcher's hand and gets us really up close.
I'm exploring the rocky shore in New England.
It's just one person talking. So, you know, I feel that's a classic use of Instagram right there. Then there's also
feeding training.
This is the Frost Science Museum in Miami. Here's another example of an Instagram video that's fairly simple. It's just somebody talking about what's going on with the spoonbills. I'm gonna press play here, and it's about a minute long video here on Instagram.
This is Richard, our aviculturist, doing a feeding training session with our rosiest spoonbills. They get their name spoonbill for that spoon-shaped bill. They use this bill to sift through sediment, which allows them to catch fish, invertebrates, and crustaceans, which are their main food source. They actually get this pink coloration from their food source as well through beta carotenoids.
So as you can see, this is also a fairly simple video. It's one shot of the spoonbills getting their meal and with somebody narrating what's going on. So it doesn't involve an incredible amount of editing or video production work. And I want to show you an example now on Twitter, which a few of you said you get a lot of videos on. This is one about how sinkholes form. So let's just start from here. Stop it right there. And I'm going to go back to slideshow. So hopefully you're looking at the PowerPoint. So I wanted to just show you those examples. In the Twitter example, you saw that text was used. And that's often the case in Facebook videos as well, because people tend to turn off the sound, not watch with the sound on Facebook and Twitter. Whereas in YouTube, people are actually watching, they're listening, they're getting more involved in the subject and what they're saying. With Twitter, I think that text works very well, as it does on Facebook. And now I wanna show you just a really fun TikTok video. This is sort of, exemplary of the kind of TikTok videos that are out there. So let me go back to the Google Chrome page, if I can here. I'm gonna pause this and then start. Sorry about that. Let's see if I can maybe stop the share and then start with this. Here we go. Okay, so I was trying to find some TikTok type videos that are science-y. And this is an example of something you might see. This is a TikTok video.
Can you chop off the bottom of lettuce? Don't throw it out. Instead, put it in a container or a bowl, fill it with water, and it's gonna regrow a whole new lettuce. Check out this 1 week time lapse.
So as you can see, TikTok is all about just being fun, catchy, having some fun music in there. Let me get the PowerPoint back on. I will share the screen again with PowerPoint. So those are, a different variety of things you can do. But as you can see that all of the videos there had interesting visuals. They had some kind of engaging person speaking, the TikTok content creator that you saw, his name is Armin. He's based in Denmark and he has 130,000 followers on Instagram and more than 1.6 million on TikTok. So he's gone viral with his catchy videos all about plants and how to regrow pineapples and lettuce. And then you have, engaging interview subjects in the more long form piece that you saw on YouTube. Another really important ingredient of videos is you know, telling an interesting story. So, you know, breaking down your science through, you know, your own anecdotes and specifics, and being very clear and very, you know, easy to understand. And that's where both your voiceover, which is essentially narration, and text comes in as very important. Let's go into this here as a very important part of the story. And in terms of a narration, as you heard in these videos, you know, they were very clear, they were concise, they avoided jargon. You didn't hear too much scientific, you know, acronyms or jargon in any of those videos. They were all very to the point and relatable to a general audience. And the text cards that were used on that Twitter video also were short, concise, and digestible. You know, they talk about using snackable text, things that people can just digest very quickly when you're making a video like this. So now you're probably wondering, well, how do I actually make one of these myself? And, you know, you don't need much more than a smartphone, really. I use my iPhone to make videos these days. I used to carry around a very heavy video camera with a heavy tripod and take it on long flights. And I found that my iPhone can actually do quite a stellar job, especially for social media platforms like Instagram, where you can get close-ups and you can get really nice, you know, footage. You know, if you want to get interviews, I would recommend using a separate recorder, a digital recorder. And then a lot of phone editing softwares are pretty easy to use nowadays. In fact, one of the reasons I like using Instagram Reels is because you can actually do the editing right within the app. And then, you know, if you want, you can get extra, you know, advanced if you have a tripod or a selfie stick to put your mic on. And the other thing you need to think about is who is going to tell the story. Is the story going to be about you and your work that you're doing? Are you going to appear on camera yourself? Or is it going to be about somebody else? Is it going to be about somebody you work with in your lab or a colleague that you do research with? But actually, a lot of times the first person videos of you speaking directly on camera can be the most effective, where you are just looking into the camera and explaining your work. And, you know, as you saw, the shots were very effective. You could see close-up shots of things like lettuce growing in that TikTok video, or you saw the shot of the Louisiana fisherman on his boat. And that was a very up close and personal shot. And so those shots have to be, again, you know, something that you think about when you're working on a video idea. And then also the script that you write is also essential. It should be very easy to understand, as I've said, and the text can accompany the script. In a lot of the cases, you know, such as Facebook and Twitter, people are going to be reading the text and not actually listening to any sound. So the text might even be more important than your narration. And now you might be wondering, well, how exactly do I use the smartphone to film? And it's quite easy. It's, you know, I use an iPhone, so I use my camera app video function. A lot of times I end up just taking still photographs. And in this, and what I can do is I can string together the still photographs in Instagram and put audio on top of them. So it turns into a almost video slideshow. And you can also record your own voice or the voice of your interview subjects using the Voice Memo app on your iPhone or a recording app if you have an Android. In terms of video editing, the easiest software to install is iMovie. And that one is something that a lot of people find very user-friendly. You know, in my case, I want to be a little bit more advanced, so I use Adobe software. And I won't get too deep into how to edit, but I've included a couple of lists here, links to lists for video editing software. And that's one of the reasons, again, I like to go into Instagram, because it's actually quite simple to share your work without getting too deep into editing. Let me see if I can go back into my Chrome here. Here we are. So for example, I was walking around. I've been spending a lot of time in the outdoors recently. And this is a reel I made. I just ended up taking a lot of short clips of redwoods in the botanical garden in Santa Barbara, where I visit. And I essentially strung together three clips with some music. Woke up to the morning sky first, baby blue just like we rehearsed. When I get up off this ground, I should leave back down to the brown, 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 till I'm clean. So that's an example of, it's four short clips strung together with some music. And Instagram captions are very effective. So you can, you can use captions. I actually used to use more still photos, and you can explain your work where you don't even have to narrate, because people might not even listen to the audio, and the caption can actually explain, what they're seeing. So if you're in your lab, you can get four or five shots. And then within Instagram Reels, you just break it down and choose your 3 to 4 seconds from each shot and create a 15 to 30 second reel with your caption explaining it. There's some really interesting ways to use video on Instagram Stories as well. And NASA has a story, let's see if it's still up, because Instagram Stories are viewable through the profile picture here, which in this case is NASA's logo. They're only up for 24 hours. So let's see if this one is still up. It is. This is a scientist talking directly to her audience.
35 miles per hour in 24 hours, they have gone through rapid intensification. The impact of climate change on hurricanes is mostly seen in the amount of tropical cyclones that in recent years have reached intensities of category 3 and up, many of these systems rapidly intensifying. Hurricane Maria in 2017 increased from category 1 to category 5 hurricane in just 24 hours. In 2020, 10 storms rapidly intensified in the Atlantic.
So one of the reasons I like showing an example of Instagram Stories is because it allows you to be very simple and straightforward. In this case, you saw the scientists essentially had the camera set up, right in front, either on a tripod or holding it on a selfie stick, and just explained a few essential tidbits in a row. And each in the story, each clip can be up to 15 seconds. So there were three clips of her answering questions from various audience members in a very, again, simple way. There's also the Science Channel, which I think has, these are extremely polished videos, but they have an amazing assortment of reels that just show you up close, things like sea turtles here. As you can see, you don't even need to be listening to the audio. Because the footage is just so interesting. To see a sea turtle so up close and personal is rare for someone like me, who's not in a, in a science setting and doesn't get to be in those places. So, being able to see any sort of lab experiment, even a 15 second clip with a caption, can be quite intriguing. Here's another one where the caption explains what's going on. There's no text, there's no narration. It's music, which is optional. And the caption really does the job. Again, this is not going to be as in-depth as a YouTube video. It's fairly bare bones, but at least exposes people to this topic. So let me go back to the PowerPoint here. So when you're filming with your iPhone or your smartphone, Android, you know, these are the major, you know, things that you need to keep in mind. First of all, hold your camera as steady as possible. It's fairly simple to do that with an iPhone because it's so small, or with your smartphone, and don't move it too much. Just keep it steady and shoot clips of 10 to 15 seconds each. And, you know, if you're going to be putting together, say, an Instagram reel, like the one I showed you, the redwoods there, I probably filmed 7 or 8 shots of 15 seconds each. And then I picked 4 of them and I ended up picking 4 second clips from each one. So that's 4 second clips times 4, that's 20 seconds for a reel. Again, this is very, very different from documentary production. This is more geared for the world of getting bite-sized videos out to a large population on Instagram, on social media. And again, the attention span of people on social media is shorter. So that's why I tell everyone to use their strongest short shots first. You know, in terms of camera angles, variety is very important. And I'm going to show you some examples of different shots here. This is what I would call an action shot. For me, actually, just seeing action, seeing somebody doing something is the most compelling. You know, if I see, for example, I saw the scientists feeding that spoonbill. But it wasn't, I mean, it was interesting, but I wish it was just a little closer up. I wish I could see his hand, or I could see the, you know, the spoonbill's beak on the researcher's hand as opposed to so far away. So I tend to want to get as close as possible to the action. And I just think it's very interesting to see things happening, unfolding in front of me. You know, setting the scene is quite important. This is a shot that I took. I was doing a story about maternity hospital in Manila in the Philippines, and I wanted to show how crowded it was. There's about 4 to 5 new mothers per bed. And this was actually shot in 2015, back when Instagram was more square photographs. But even in a square photograph, you can just see how densely populated this maternity ward is. So it really sets the scene. Here's another wide shot. You know, it's a classroom and you can see the girls raising their hands. So it's, again, it's action and it's an establishing, you know, shot where you are. In this case, it's a classroom in India. Then medium shots are the other kind of shot. So this, you know, I always tell people, get as close to your subjects as possible. So especially when people are watching videos on an iPhone or an Android, you have to show them things close up. You know, the further away you are, the further removed your audience is going to feel from your video. So in this case, I was doing a video about a young girl in Nepal who is, you know, in her home, and she's studying and doing her homework here. And so I tried to get as close as possible without being intrusive. And, you know, it helps if you have a rapport with your subject, or if you yourself are your subject, and you can get a little bit closer like this. So I was able to, you know, get to know her and her family fairly well. This was a number of years ago, and I'm still friends on Facebook with them because I got to know them, and that helps. So getting to know your subject, they let you get close. And here I was able to get sort of over the shoulder, a shot of her dress and her bracelets. And I want to see if I can go back a little here. So, you know, I've included another bullet point here. You can also move the camera slowly. If you want to show a scene from left to right, you can move your camera, which is called panning. and move very slowly. And that can actually show people what the scene looks like. So if you're on a boat and you want to show the water that you're in, you can pan from left to right and show exactly what you're seeing. And I have some examples of that, but I want to show you a 360 video that I did. I'm not getting too deep into 360 video because it's not really shareable on Instagram or Twitter, but it is on Facebook. So let's go back to Google Chrome here, if we can. So this is a video that I made about a Navajo family that lives in Arizona, and they live on the Navajo Nation, and they're experiencing extreme drought due to climate change. And I wanted to showcase the person that I was really focusing on the video on. So I asked her to hold a selfie stick with a camera attached to it. And I got this, and I'll show you a few pans later, but let me just show you starting with this.
The water running out of the ground. We used to take.
If you work in a team, you should be using Monday.com. It's a platform to manage any team and any work.
Go back to this. That's the other problem with YouTube. You have ads, which you don't in Instagram. And
to take our shoot there to drink water. And now today we have to haul water for them. There's no longer water in these earthen dams. They're all dry. We have to go to the windmill to get water. We take a truck over there. It has 500 gallon tank on it. Then we fill it up with water. Then we bring it back here for the sheet.
I hook up the water.
So in this case, you can see, you know, when we're walking with her, we're driving with her, we're seeing everything through her point of view. And the thing with 360 videos,
we
can actually
haul water for them.
Move the camera.
There's no longer water in these earthen dams. They're all dry.
So you can
we
see
have
what
to
she's
go to the windmill
at.
To get water. But we take a
Here's another shot where it's a wide shot of
the water for our livestock right now. That's a tradition in the Navajo that you have animals. Sheep herding is vanishing in our area. We're only the last few shepherds out here. There used to be water running out of the ground. We used to take our sheep there to drink water. And now today we have to haul water for them.
So the reason I would like to show that is because it, you know, in this video, you can see both Lorraine, the horse herder, and you can see what she's looking at, which is quite an interesting way to view videos.
There's no longer.
And it gives the user the ability to move around and see everything around her. But if you're making a non 360 video, just a regular video, what you can do is you can move the camera yourself from right to left, and the pan will essentially show what you're seeing on the left and right. So, you know, I have some pretty simple pans that I put on my own reels. Again, mostly flowers. That is a simple pan right here. This is another pan. I use a lot of Beatles music. So, you know, panning can give you a sense of what is around you, and it lets the audience into your life here. And I just want to, I know we want to move into questions before we end here, but I want to talk about using yourself as a subject, because I think that is very effective in being able to convey your science to people. You know, and I think being able to get on camera and holding the camera and showing yourself doing the work, showing yourself walking through the field or sitting in your lab can be very a very effective way to communicate your work and your findings. And you know, these videos are fairly simple to make. You can hold the camera up to whatever you're doing and you can show what you're seeing. So for example, you can be walking through a salt marsh, you can be sailing on a boat, and people are basically seeing it through your own eyes. And let me go back to an example of what that could look like. I have to go back into, it's probably a very easy way to do this that I will one day learn. Back into Google Chrome. I want to show you actually a scientist who's made a video just documenting herself. She lives in the Gulf in the South and she goes through mangroves. So let me stop this share and start a new share here. And this is it. So she is on camera and she's showing you how she does her work in the field.
So in the field, we carry an instrument called a refractometer, and it's very portable and obviously fairly small. You can fit it into a backpack, and it measures the refractive index of a solution. The more salts that are contained in the solution, the more the light is refracted, and that is reflected in a salinity scale that can be seen through the ocular of the refractometer. And so the way this works.
So this this woman, the scientist videographer, is someone who, I mean, she has an entire YouTube channel explaining to scientists how to make these kind of videos. And again, as you can see, it's pretty simple. She set up a camera, she's in a mangrove, and she's just talking about this instrument that she uses. You know, another example could be her walking through. You know, here she's actually on a boat, which I thought was even more interesting because I prefer to see action. So she may have had a friend or colleague get that footage for her. And, you know, she also has videos that explain how to make your science videos appealing to viewers. And the first tip she says is show where you work and describe what it's like to work there, which I thought is just the best thing for anyone that's making a video. You know, if you're making a video about a doctor, if you're making a video about a chef, about a scientist, like just show where exactly you are. So I'm gonna play a few seconds here.
The best ways to insert human interest is to show where you work and describe what it's like to do research there.
One of the best ways to see mangroves is by kayak. You can get into very tight spots that a larger boat cannot get into. And also you can be very quiet. And often you see animals such as manatees that you normally don't see when traveling in a boat because they make so much noise that it scares the animals away.
To
point it out.
There's some buoyancy to this marsh. And I'm going to walk away from here and then okay. Everything will rebound. So.
Talk about a challenge you faced and how you overcame it. Describe how your curiosity led you to a discovery. Explain what you like most about science or your research topic.
So this video is actually included in my resources guide. But, you know, I thought here's another good example. The scientist is in the field and he's just showing how excited he is to be there and to be able to see this. And his excitement quickly, you know, gets to the audience and gets them excited.
Saw or experience that allows you to express your enthusiasm for science.
Well, we're in the inner delta of the Okavango Delta system in Botswana, and I've been in many wetlands all over the world, but this is the first time I've seen a megafaunal animal like an elephant in a wetland environment. You can see he's crossing the river right now. It's just absolutely incredible experience to see an elephant in a wetland. Just amazing.
So, you know, we're just excited that he's excited and, you know, we're seeing what he's seeing. And again, this is very simple to do. He's just put the camera on selfie mode and he's filming himself with the elephant behind him and just giving us kind of like a news documentary filmmaker, you know, or someone who's a presenter would do, you know, like a news anchor, live commentary on what's going on. And it can be quite interesting to watch. Let me go back to the PowerPoint here. And, you know, there's a lot of other, you know, things that you can do with video, but these are the most simple things is, you know, creating a storyboard. So, you know, create a vision for what your video wants to look like. So a lot of video people we'll just put post-it notes on a wall talking about what shots they want. And then, you know, come up with a very easy script. It could be unscripted, you know, like that researcher who was in Botswana with the elephant. He was just talking off the cuff and explaining live what he's seeing. And again, it's easy to understand. It's language that explains the topic. And if you're going to use text, make sure that the text is matching the images that you're seeing on screen. You know, I showed you some examples that have text. In Instagram stories, as you saw that NASA story, you just type in your words on top of the photos and the videos. So you don't even need to do any kind of text editing. The Instagram stories in-app editor does everything for you. And, you know, just make sure it's short and sweet. And, you know, music is another important part of videos that, you know, I'm gonna share this slideshow with you. So I've included some links to where you can get free music. There are a number of great archives. And I wanna get to questions, but, you know, you may wonder, well, how do I decide where to post my video? In my case, as I've mentioned, I tend to use Instagram quite often because it has the in-app editor that allows you to make reels very easily, and stories are also fairly straightforward, and then the text can just be typed right into the Instagram story. So if you have less time on your hands and you don't want to get involved with too much editing, Instagram stories and Instagram reels allows you to edit these clips together right within the app. But as we learned in that poll, YouTube and Facebook have the greatest reach. So, you know, if you want to reach a larger audience, if you want to do a more in-depth piece with more analysis, Facebook and YouTube are the way to go, but it needs more editing. And then, you know, if you want to be short and fun and catchy, TikTok is really the place to get younger audience with more catchy, fun, musical videos that are kind of creative and thinking outside the normal video capabilities. You can also create multiple versions. So, you know, when I was creating videos for news organizations, I would create a short one for Instagram and then a longer one for the YouTube. And you could have two different versions of the same topic. And, you know, I'm going to get deeper into storyboarding in the workshop and how to come up with shots and how to actually shoot some of these shots. But for now, I know we're wrapping up and time is short, so I'd love to take your questions.
Thank you so much, Sonia. We really appreciate this incredible overview of so many things that we should know about for video storytelling. So everybody, please, you know, jump in. You can either, you know, raise your hand or you can enter a question in the chat, whatever you'd prefer. Sure, there's someone out there who's got a question. While we're waiting for that, Sonia, go ahead.
No, I can ask you a question. You know, I'm curious, has anyone made a video or tried to make a video, and where did they post it?
Okay, here they start to come in now. Okay, so Jim first had a question. Can you comment on user metrics and assessing your video strategy? Great question.
Yeah, that is a good question. So, you know, in terms of coming up with a strategy for where you're going to put your video, you know, it depends on who you're working for. You know, as a journalist, I often find that the views on generally on Facebook and on Twitter are higher than YouTube, because the news outlets I worked for, as Sunshine mentioned, PRI's The World, didn't have an established YouTube viewership base. But if I worked for a museum or worked for a university, like for example, UC Berkeley, UC Berkeley's science labs have the ability to post on UC Berkeley's official Instagram page, and they have a giant following on their YouTube and Instagram page. So if you work for a university where you can get your videos on an existing page, you're generally going to have big numbers on there, so you don't have to build an audience. So I would look at, well, where do my highest followings exist? And try to also see if your videos could get beyond your own personal page, but be shared on official pages that are part of maybe URI or even other organizations that you do work with, and then decide where to go from there. Just go with the ones that have a built-in audience already.
Great, thanks. I'm going to ask some of the more logistical questions, and if we have time, we'll get into some of the bigger ones. So Peter asked whether you had any suggestions for how to record the best quality audio.
That's a good question. So when you're recording on a smartphone, the audio is going to be okay for the footage that you're actually just filming. But if you want to get a scientist or an interview, there's two ways to do that. You could use your voice memo or your recording or in-app software on your phone and get close up to, I give a whole session on how to record audio because I work in radio, and you have to be about 4 to 6 inches from the person. A lot of times I actually ask my interview subjects to record on their own, because nowadays I've been doing a lot of Zoom interviews. So I essentially just say, put your iPhone up on a stack of books that's 4 to 6 inches from your mouth, and can I just interview you for half an hour on Zoom? And the quality of the audio turns out great. You know, I keep talking about iPhones because I am an iPhone user. But the other way to do it is to get a portable digital recorder. And that would actually give you a higher quality audio. But I actually think that in the era of Zoom and the pandemic, people don't expect extremely high quality audio interviews. So I think a smartphone recording would be fine.
Great. Thank you. Amanda asks whether you have advice on making videos accessible beyond captions.
So that is a good question. In terms of accessible beyond captions, do you mean accessible to people who are not going to be reading the text?
Can you add to your question, Amanda, or just unmute?
So things like, so that people who visually limited may be able to follow along.
Okay, that's what I was thinking. Folks that are not going to be watching the text. In that case, I would focus on making sure that the audio explains everything. So I would, you know, as I went through some examples that were just music and didn't have any narration, or making sure that the caption, in a lot of cases, there's captions that can be read out loud by a computer software. So if I had a video that didn't have any narration, it was just text, then I would make sure that the caption on Instagram or on YouTube, the description was very clear and explained everything that the user who was visually limited could then play on their computer and just listen to the caption being read out loud by their software.
Great. So JP asked a question that I thought might take a little bit longer to respond to, which was, this takes a lot of time. He notes that he takes a ton of pictures and videos, but struggles to find the energy to post. So how do you motivate beyond, of course, the like financial incentive of doing the jobs you're paid for?
That is a good question that applies to me too. I take way too many videos and way too many pictures that I often just end up storing on my hard drive. And my family just says, you are just buying hard drives and not posting any of it. So you're just buying hard drives for the sake of storing all of this. And I think what gives me the energy really is the interaction with the audience. And I didn't get a chance to get into that much. But for me, it's the engagement with my viewers. And when I start posting things that people find very interesting and compelling, a lot of times back when I used to go into the field, pre-pandemic, I went to places like Nepal and I was covering, the stories of women after the earthquake. And then people would ask me questions. They would say, oh, can you tell me what are the biggest struggles that women are facing? And then I would answer the questions. And then they would ask me more questions. And it was this dialogue that I was having based on a photo or a video that I posted. And then it got me more interested because I thought, wow, like I'm sitting in this remote village, unable to talk to my audience, but I'm isolated, but I can have this one-on-one connection with people through my photographs. And really that's what motivates me the most is the ability for my photos to get questions from the public. And as you saw, you can even have Q&A sessions. A lot of people do that. They go on Instagram stories and they say, please ask me all your questions. And then people will get questions in and then they just answer their questions live, like I'm doing right now. And this could be a little Instagram story. So I think if you are able to get people asking you questions, you might feel more motivated to post your pictures because you knew there were people out there that were looking or wanted to know more.
Wonderful. In the interest of time, I think we'd better pause right here. Thank you so much, Sonia, for this really fantastic talk and responding to all these questions. So, of course, those of you who are staying for the workshop,